So yesterday I confronted the technical team with this and I said I want to do my presentation on SD423 DVD. And they gave me their Nosferatu face. No, but they were so kind to put the image file on this laptop. So I can do it actually from DVD. So in this room, the DVD is already an obsolescent medium. And even at ZKM, this is the case. So the DVD, as you know, the grandmother of the DVD is the laser disc. So I do a small illustration to the introduction. The necessity of rescuing analog media has given rise to a virtue, the will to valorize the long unpublished holdings of electronic art archives in cooperation with media artists, museums, and other cultural institutions. Each media archaeology exhibition made possible by restoration and digitization reopens discussion of both the visual and the art historical aspects of video art in the processual play of the archive. Ultimately, archive exhibitions, including their publications and budgets, are actually research projects. This important insight was already presciently moving into the foreground in 2006 with 40 years of video art, the ZKM's very first video archive exhibition then. In the catalog, the curator Rudolf Frieling states, 40 years of video art accentuates a significant void in the art and media historical reappraisal of the history of video art, this obscure terrain of copies, masters, submasters, copy of copies, new archive masters, etc. Video is relative. We have to operate under this condition. And the phrase video is relative he took from the artist Jean-François Guiton. So now I'm going to present our latest media archive project published this year. So actually it was printed just like 2 or 3 weeks ago. So it's brand new. The Joseph Beuys video edition titled Joseph Beuys Actions 1963 till 1986. The box comes as an edition of 2,000 pieces, including a 500 pages booklet. So this is a booklet in Peter Weibel style. So Peter Weibel, our CEO. So this is the booklet that comes with the box. And it's in English and German language. The editor is, of course, Peter Weibel, and it's published at Buchhandlung Walter König. So very prominent piece of media edition. The video edition includes audiovisual material of 29 Joseph Beuys actions and 4 pieces of bonus material, altogether over 10 hours of material. And now we are getting to the interesting point. It is published on SD423 DVD. And you will need a laptop like my old laptop, which has still a DVD drive, or an old-fashioned DVD player with a matching display to have the ultimate viewing pleasure. So in this room, you would not be able to watch the content. So the DVD sales statistics for Germany say still in the year 2021, DVDs were sold for 230 million euro. To compare, in the same year in Germany, video streaming was sold for 2 billion euro. DVDs are already turning into obsolete media. Maybe this will be the last DVD edition published by ZKM. So revaluation and obsolescence in one product. This sounds already paradox. The project started 2015 when the physical Joseph Beuys Media Archive moved to ZKM. It included over 350 pieces of media. But for the edition, we had to consult international institutions for additional master tapes for example, the Centre Pompidou, Paris. And here we see the transport box. This is the Pompidou media of Joseph Beuys. And here we see an Instagram post. Very rarely an archive space develops into a hip space where everybody wants to be seen at. So Klaus Biesenbach, literally in the midst of it, visiting the Joseph Beuys Media and Performance Archive as guest of Peter Weibel and his incredible team. And after 5 hours, it had over 500 likes. So now we are getting to the revaluation aspect. Celebrating 30 years ahead of the curve in art, the institutional procedure of collecting and presenting electronic art was described in this New York Times ZKM birthday article in 2019. That year, the Laboratory of Antiquated Video Systems had its 15th birthday, as it was founded in the year 2004. So I read a little bit of the article. When you buy and collect media work, you must also buy an engineer for maintenance all the time, Mr. Peter Weibel explained. While ZKM is largely future-facing, much of the art it collects uses technology that regularly becomes obsolete and requires more or less constant repair. The center is closed on 2 days a week for upkeep, but individual works are often on the fritz, which means out of order. Weibel aims offering a model for other institutions who might be hesitant to show media works. This is the main mission of the ZKM, he said, to show people what is possible. Not what is real, he added, but what is possible. So later in the article, the American artist and filmmaker Lynn Hirschman Leeson was one of the first artists to integrate artificial intelligence into works, among them the interactive chatbot Agent Ruby. But before 2014, she said in an interview, "Nobody would show my work." That year, nearly 800 of her works appeared in a retrospective at ZKM, and many of them were then sold to major collections and museums. Mrs. Hirschman Leeson said that the show gave value to my work and really gave me many options for the rest of my life. So to go deeper into the revaluation aspect, a perfect example of the way the dilemma of technological mortality affects video art in particular is provided by the Audiovisual Archive of CAVS, the Center for Advanced Visual Studies at MIT Boston, which contains about 250 videos from the 60s through the 80s, including a great deal of video art and documentation. Since the center's founding in 1967, the video industry has released over 50 different video standards featuring various color and black and white models, running speeds, recording settings, and country-specific characteristics. Each work in the archive was made with a video recorder of its time and place. To be able to play and digitize the contents of the entire archive at optimal quality, one would need, after careful assessment, a well-maintained pool of video devices covering at least 10 of the historical video standards and subcategories represented. Today, analog and digital video on magnetic tape, especially 4:3 video, has inevitably joined the fossils of cultural history. Its demise was hastened by the shift to 16:9 HD video and the dominance of digital video editing with computers and modern storage media. Other indicators, including this historic press release from Sony, quote, "With the global trend of migration towards file-based operation, Sony plans to cease sales and distribution of professional videotape recorders, players, and camcorders targeting around the end of March 2016. There is also the fact that in 2016, the last analog VHS video cassette recorder rolled off the assembly lines of the Japanese company Funai Electric." So These factors add up to a paradoxical situation in which even MIT in Boston, like most institutions around the world, no longer possess the technology to read their own tape archives. Even deeper into the technical aspects of the revaluation process, to take one example from the conservatorial journey from analog tape to digital master, consider the CAVS archives tapes of the 1977 installation of MIT Centerbeam, shown at the Documenta 6 in Kassel. So now you must have noticed the MIT archive went over the Atlantic to ZKM and finally arrived at the laboratory here. There are 8 Sony and Scotch-branded U-Mati cassettes, 4 of them 60 minutes long and the rest 30. Each of the Centerbeam U-Mati tapes will undergo cleaning using an RTI VT tape cleaner and, if necessary, thermal treatment to get it into the best possible condition. We use a HERA term, laboratory often. It's taken from biochemistry. It's an incubator. And then to be read back on an appropriate recorder model, so we use Sony BVU series for high band, Sony VP series for low. The resulting video signal will be turned into a digital master that is an uncompressed video file, 4:3, 10-bit PAL or NTSC in this case, with an analog to digital converter. We use AJ or Blackmagic design. We are not very dogmatic about this. The audio signal will be taken from the video recorder's line-out jack, possibly converted into symmetrical XLR audio with a Sonyfex red box and labeled with an analog mixing board such as the Mackie and digitized as well. So these digital masters are to be entered into the ZKM's digital preservation repository in as unaltered state as possible, so without analog or digital post-processing modifications. The aim is to prevent video information from being irrecoverably edited out over time by hasty, overzealous post-processing. Our contemporary visual habits, shaped by 16:9 high-definition recordings, differ significantly from those of the 60s and 70s with respect to contrast and color. These digital heritage masters can be used for years to come as high-resolution source material for digital post-production or for reprocessing when new compressors become available, or if artificial intelligence wants to take over the post-processing process. So who knows how this will be in a few years. So as data repository, we use LTO Altrium 6, as we have seen at the guided tour yesterday. About the videos, today, nearly 40 years after their creation, the Centerbeam videos live again on the laboratory CRTs. We see on the field in front of Kassel's Orangerie the 61-meter-long structure with its 24 supports, its tubes and cables carrying compressed air, gas, water, steam, neon, argon, sound, electricity, and media. A glowing, hissing art machine constructed by 14 artists and numerous specialists that produced eyes, fog, and images. All the technological elements can be easily seen, as well as many details that could not otherwise have been documented, such as the sound of the piece, its interactions with its natural and architectural surroundings, scenes from its installation, and the reactions of the public. Many of CAVS artworks have been impossible to maintain in functional condition. Similarly, it's unclear whether Centerbeam can ever be shown again in its old form, even though it has been preserved in a fragmentary state. However, it has been exhibited at ZKM 2017, Centerbeam, a performative sculpture by CAVS, which was done by Morgan. And a little bit later, in addition, the so-called Center Book about this whole process was published by CAVS and ZKM. It was a collaboration. So there was even kind of a catalog in the end. So the first conclusion I have about this, not what is real, but what is possible, Peter Weibel said. So between the arrival of the Josef Beuys Media Archive in 2015 and the publication date this year, even more reevaluating research media projects took place at ZKM. Aldo Tambellini was, like Otto Piene and many others, also an active member of the Center for Advanced Visual Studies. His personal Aldo Tambellini archive with over 500 video media was restored and digitized at ZKM and led to the monumental exhibition Black Matters in the year 2017. Then Aldo was in his late 80s, and during the preparation, we were sending videos back and forth to discuss the condition and what to take for the exhibition and so on. Unfortunately, there was no funding for a catalog, but I fancy a digital catalog for this exceptional exhibition in the future. So maybe next year this becomes fashionable to do the catalogs online. And without mentioning a variety of further ZKM video activities, I absolutely would like to present the Radical Software exhibition subtitled The Rain Dance Foundation, Media Ecology and Video Art, which took place in the year 2017-18 as well. Altogether, the archive contains around 530 pieces of media. Ira Schneider initiated the overseas transfer of the archive from MoMA, New York, in the year 2009. He did not see a chance to get it digitized there because they don't have their own video lab in-house. As we have a look at some of Frank Gillette's U-matic tapes next, another member of the Rain Dance Foundation, it becomes crystal clear why so many institutions hesitate to initiate archaeologic video art projects. And this is Ira Schneider himself during the digitization process making fun of the ZKM cloud, an artificial cloud of the art group Transolar was exhibited 2015 at the ZKM Globale exhibition. Today, we still store our digital masters not cloud-based, but very conservative on LTO tapes. In summary, we store over 1 petabyte video material in our long-term storage. Every year, we digitize around 1,000 videotapes. That is approximately 2 or 3 archives, which allows us to realize 2 or 3 projects, exhibitions, editions, or collaborations. So my last conclusion, a paradoxical situation. Now I would like to present some of the very last unicorns, video laboratories around the world who are still able to digitize obsolete video formats at a scale that is appropriate for larger projects. Just to prove ZKM is not the only one, but the one of a few that is embedded in a governmental institution. So, first, we see Adam Lockhart, who is here with us. He's situated at the Dundee University in Scotland. The Rewind Media Preservation Lab was established 2004 and is one of only a few such facilities in Europe specializing in the preservation of artist media. The lab was established as part of the first original Rewind project, artist video in the 1970s and 80s of the UK, published in the year 2012. In possession of the laboratory, Professor Stephen Partridge could realize numerous research restoration projects over the years, such as Rewind Italia, early video art in Italy, published 2015, and EVA, European women's video art in the 70s and 80s, published 2019. And I also want to present the upcoming symposium Sustaining Art at Dundee, and Adam is hosting it. So if you need some information. And here we see Bill Seary and Maurice Schächter at their laboratory called Standby.org on Long Island. They provide their service, among others, to almost all the museums of New York, like Guggenheim, MoMA, etc. One video installation restored by them is now in the permanent show at MoMA New York, the Gretchen Bender installation Dumping Core of 1984. The Standby Program is a non-profit media art service organization founded in 1983. Standby's mission is to foster the creation and preservation of media artwork by democratizing access to media technology, providing technical consultation, and creating resources to advance the development of the field. And finally, I was very lucky to get a short email interview for this lecture with Jonathan Formanski, the Associate Conservator of Audiovisual Materials of the Getty Research Institute. Listen, here at the GRI, I operate an in-house reformatting facility dedicated to the migration of various obsolete analog and digital audiovisual formats, very similar, by the looks of it, to your laboratory for antiquated video systems. Favorite tapes he just did are of Cynthia Morgan, he writes. The collection is a bit of an absurdist diary in shape and content, and I was able to digitize the entire batch of around 45 open reel tapes over the course of about a year. Asked about European standards, we do have PAL capabilities here at the GRI. The acquisition of the Harald Seemann archive came with hundreds of VHS tapes that are mostly of PAL European vintage. I recently got a Sony U-matic deck that can do PAL and SECAM. I can't do PAL half-inch open reel. So paradox, the archives are shipped back and forth over the Atlantic. So Harald Seemann archive is digitized at Getty, and the MoMA archive, Raindance, or the MIT archive are digitized here at ZKM. So, and one thing probably all the laboratories share, the poor knowledge transfer situation. Formanski wrote, and I was very amazed about that fact, I am the sole occupant of my laboratory. Just. While we do sometimes use outside vendors for film materials and other large projects with large batches of tape, I do most all the treatments, transfer, repair, and upkeep of the AV materials here at the GRI. Because of the film and television industries here in Los Angeles, there are a number of companies that work with legacy media materials, but that usually only goes as far back as U-matic. Due to the nature of items in my care, these are most often part of the GRI special collections. The powers that be prefer them to be done here on site by a conservator, me, and to our archival specifications. I have worked with students at neighboring UCLA who are in the Mills program, Masters of Library Science, and specializing in AV archiving, and have attempted to share my knowledge. End of the quote. And end of the presentation as well. Thanks.